Welcome to Learning English, a daily 30-minute program from the Voice of America. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter, Jr. This program is designed for English learners, so we speak a little slower and we use words and phrases especially written for people learning English.
On today's program, Brian Lynn has a report on an Olympic hopeful in the sport of breakdancing. Jill Robbins presents a new everyday grammar lesson. She introduces words you can use when describing summer vacations. We close the show with the lesson of the day. But first,
an American breakdancer says she hopes the sport's debut at the Paris Olympics next month will help energize the games. 21-year-old Logan Edra recently spoke with reporters from Reuters about breakdancing's introduction to Olympic competition. "Breaking is going to do so well in Paris," Edra told the news service. This breakdancer, or breaker, from Southern California also goes by the nickname Logistics. The word is similar to the term logistics, which means to organize something in a productive way. Her father gave her that name because, as a child, she always knew how to get where she wanted to go. Breakdancing is believed to have started in the Bronx area of New York City in the 1970s. The sport is now preparing to make its Olympic debut. The Paris Games opening ceremony is on July 26th. A total of 32 breakdancers are set to compete, 16 men and 16 women. The dancers are also known as B-boys or B-girls. "I pray that we bring the most hype and steal attention from the other sports," said Edra. "They are going to hear the music and they are going to be so curious, like, what's going on?" Edra was born in Chula Vista, California, and is a second-generation Filipino-American. In addition to her own training, she teaches breakdancing at a dance school in Los Angeles. Reporters from Reuters recently visited the school. "We need music in our lives," she shouted before turning up the hip-hop music the students trained to. Edra then connected with the music and was soon demonstrating her dance skills that included head spins, flips, and complex footwork. "Are you a B-girl already?" she asked one student after she pulled off one of her moves. She then added, "We're just having fun. That's all we're doing." Edra's skills helped her win the B-girl division of the Red Bull BC1 World Championship in 2021 in Gdansk, Poland. Some have compared breakdancing to boxing because of the one-on-one nature of its competitive battles. The sport also has similarities to gymnastics. But Edra said she thinks it is more closely related to skateboarding, which permits competitors to demonstrate deep creative and technical abilities. Skateboarding quickly became one of the most popular Olympic sports following its debut at the 2021 Tokyo Games. Edra told Reuters she is looking forward to competing and is even hoping to become the first woman to win a gold medal in the sport. She still must officially qualify for the Paris Games during an event later this month in Budapest, Hungary. She just needs to finish in the top 16 to qualify. Edra said she trains twice a day. Most mornings, she centers on building technical skills. Later in the day, she seeks to improve her dance creativity and fully connect to the music. I can be a competitive person, so I still train very hard to focus on doing my best to win, Edra said. She then added, but we're artist athletes. She admitted that dance battles can be subjective during judging. But it's whoever is killing it that day, she added. These battles are a very fun competitive game, but it's also inspiring to see all of us bringing our own style. Edra said she sees her wins as spreading her message of unity to the world. I see any title or championship as a megaphone to amplify any message I want. I couldn't care less about the attention for personal satisfaction, she added. I represent the culture. I represent dance. I represent the peace-love community and having fun. Edra said she also sees herself as being a student of the game, caring about its evolution, and keeping it alive. I'm Brian Lynn.
This week on Everyday Grammar, we learned some of the grammar you need to talk about getting the things you need while on vacation. A common summer vacation might involve a trip to a beach or a lake. Let's say we are going to Big Bear Lake in California for a week. Because I am describing my plans like a story, I will use only the present tense. Here is how I would plan our trip. The first thing we should do is find out where we can stay. My family loves camping, so I look for a campground. On the Big Bear Lake website, it says Pine Knot Campground is good for families. Hiking and mountain biking trails are nearby. So I call and make a reservation for a campsite, a place to put up our tent. Here is how the call begins. I'd like to reserve a campsite at Pine Knot Campground for the last week of July. The verb reserve means to arrange to use something at a later date. It is a transitive verb, so you need an object. In this case, the object is a campsite. The reservation manager asks me some questions.
Do you want a tent or RV space? How many people are in your party?
The expression in your party means the number in your group. An RV, or recreational vehicle, is a camping vehicle, often with a bed and kitchen. I answer, I want a tent space for 5 people. I learn that the cost will be $42 a night. You might hear per night or a night when you make a reservation to sleep in a place. I give my credit card number to the manager to make the reservation, and she says I will get an email confirmation. Usually, a confirmation is a number or a printed code that shows you have made a reservation. With the campsite reserved, the next thing I need to do is to find mountain bike rentals. My family likes to ride bicycles in the woods, but we cannot bring our bicycles to the lake. I find a few sports shops on Big Bear Boulevard near the park. I call to see if I can rent bikes from them. I'd like to rent 5 mountain bikes for the last week of August, Note that I do not ask to borrow the bikes because I am paying to use the bikes, so I am renting them. The clerk at the shop asks,
"Kids or adults? And do you want pedal or electric ones? There are a lot of hills around here."
I had not thought about using an electric bike. It would make biking in the mountains easier. But I need more information, so I ask.
"I need 3 kids' bikes and 2 adult bikes. What is the price difference between pedal and electric?"
The clerk answers,
"Pedal is $48 a day, and electric is $120 a day. We only have electric in the adult size, though."
The price helps me to decide, because $120 a day is a very high daily rate. We will pedal. After I finish renting the bikes, there is just one more thing to plan. What will we do on the lake? I heard there are lots of water sports at Big Bear. I find a web page for the marina, the place where boats are kept. It says they have many different kinds of boats available for rent. A quiet day fishing on the lake is my family's idea of a good time. So I call to find out about renting a fishing boat. "Do you rent boats and fishing gear together?" The marina staff member answers,
"We have an all-included fishing package. That is the boat, gear, bait, and even lunch. How many people?"
This sounds like a good package. Businesses offer a package deal when one price covers a number of things that would normally be sold separately. Gear is a general word for everything you might need for an activity. For fishing, it means a pole, hooks and line, and a life jacket. I answer, 5. "How much is it for the whole day?" I learn it is $200 for the boat and $25 for the gear. I arrange to rent the boat and make a note to be sure to bring sunscreen and sun hats for everyone. In this lesson, we use some common expressions that you will hear when making reservations and renting things. They are to reserve, to make a reservation, confirmation, a night or per night, a day, price difference, package, and gear. Put these into use and you can plan your own vacation trip. Learning about all of these rental and reservation costs a month or two before our vacation makes me think. Planning ahead for a vacation is a good idea. Now, I will not be surprised by extra costs, and I will enjoy the time with my family. I hope you enjoy your vacation too. And that's Everyday Grammar. I'm Jill Robbins.
That was Jill Robbins with this week's Everyday Grammar. She is here now to talk a bit more about the lesson. Hi, Jill. Thank you for being here.
Hi, Ashley. Thanks for having me.
This week, you taught some useful words for talking about summer vacations or trips. What kinds of summer trips did you take when you were growing up?
You know, this story reminded me of when I was young and my family went to a lake in Indiana. My parents rented a log cabin, a small primitive house, and we spent a week there boating and fishing and swimming.
Log cabins are houses made of whole logs from trees, like people had many years ago. That sounds like a lot of fun. Is that where you learned how to fish?
Yes, my dad brought the gear. He called it his tackle box, the place he kept all of the hooks and fishing line and tools, and each of us kids had a fishing pole. We would go out in a boat that we rented with the cabin and explore the lake and fish all day.
So it was a package offer, like you talked about in the story. The boat came with the cabin. What kinds of fish would you catch?
It was usually little fish. We called sunfish. But one time, a turtle caught me.
Ow! Did it hurt you?
Yes, I think I had to go to the doctor or the hospital. But I still love turtles today.
Family vacations are a great way to make memories. Did you ever camp in a tent?
Sure. With a family of five, my parents could not afford hotel rooms. Every summer, we went to a different part of the U.S. My dad said he wanted us to go to the north, south, east, and west to see the whole country. And you're right about making memories. My brothers and sisters and I still talk about some of the places we saw on our camping trips.
Thanks so much for joining me today, Jill. And thanks for that everyday grammar lesson.
My pleasure, Ashley. Thanks for having me.
VOA Learning English has launched a new program for children. It is called Let's Learn English with Anna. The new course aims to teach children American English through asking and answering questions and experiencing fun situations. For more information, visit our website, learningenglish.voanews.com.
Is Anna Mateo.
My name is Andrew Smith.
And I'm Jill Robbins.
You're listening to The Lesson of the Day on the Learning English Podcast. Welcome to the part of the show where we help you do more with our video series, Let's Learn English. This series shows Anna Mateo in her work and life in Washington, D.C.
If you have watched Let's Learn English, you know that Anna has a boss named Ms. Weaver. Ms. Weaver has asked Anna to do some special projects, such as making a children's television show. In Lesson 49 of the series, Ms. Weaver tells Anna to go to a special museum in Washington.
She tells Anna to go to the International Spy Museum and learn about spying.
A spy is a person who collects secret information, or intelligence, about other countries or organizations. The most famous spy in movies is the British agent named James Bond.
The word spy is also a verb. We use the preposition on after the verb spy. So we say that a secret agent or a spy, spies on other countries.
Andrew, have you ever been to the Spy Museum in Washington, D.C.?
I haven't, but I'd really like to go there. I know you've been there.
I have been there, and it was really cool. Let's listen to the beginning of Lesson 49 and hear Anna talk about her special mission.
It is no secret that Washington, D.C. has spies. Well, it should be a secret because spying is secret, but it's not a secret. There's even a spy museum. The International Spy Museum has created an amazing collection of spy things. And today, we will see them. My boss, Ms. Weaver, has sent me here on a mission.
Hello, Anna. Are you there?
That's her. Yes, Agent Peacock. This is Agent Flamingo reporting for duty.
Agent what?
Look, Anna, Agent Flamingo. I want you to learn all you can about spying.
You mean collect intelligence?
Yeah, It's for our new show, DC Secret.
You got it, Agent Peacock. The mission is safe with me.
Oh, okay, great. Just
be back by noon.
As you watch Lesson 49, you will learn that Ms. Weaver has a few other reasons for sending Anna to the museum.
And you can notice that Anna used the code names Peacock and Flamingo to talk about herself and Ms. Weaver.
Codes use symbols, numbers, or words to give or get access to secret information. We often use the word security before the word code. For example, to enter some buildings, you must enter a security code, usually a set of numbers.
And spies often try to break codes, or figure out their meaning, to get secret information.
The code names Anna uses, Peacock and Flamingo, are actually the names of two types of large birds. Now, let's listen to the first thing Anna tries to do at the spy museum.
Agent Peacock, I'm at an air duct.
Yes, spies sometimes sneak down air ducts.
I have never snuck down an air duct. It's dark and small. I'm afraid of dark, small places.
You can do it, Agent Flamingo. You know, spies aren't afraid of a little darkness.
As you heard in one of our recent podcasts, Anna is using the present perfect tense. To make that tense, Anna used the past participle form of the verb sneak, which is snuck here. Andrew, did you know the past tense form and the past participle form can be either sneaked or snuck?
You know, when I watched the video and I heard her say sneaked, it made me think about that. And I realized, sometimes we say have snuck, sometimes we say have sneaked.
Before the late 1800s, only sneaked was considered correct. But gradually people accepted snuck. Anyway, an air duct carries cooling air or heat through a building. A person can fit inside of it, but must crawl to move through it, because air ducts are usually only about 1 meter wide and 1 meter high.
The verb sneak means to move around secretly. Listen to these prepositions that usually follow the verb sneak.
I'm going to sneak in the movie theater. I'm going to sneak in to the movie theater. They snuck around the office building.
When we go in a room without permission, we sneak in or sneak into. When we walk through more than one room or through a larger area, we sometimes say sneak around. And when we secretly go through a narrow area, we sneak down.
At Christmas time, children often sneak downstairs to see what's under the tree for them. So Anna sneaks down the air duct.
Yes, spies sometimes sneak down air ducts.
And this reminds me, in the Christmas holiday tradition, Santa Claus sneaks down the chimneys of houses to bring presents to children.
But then he has to climb back up the chimney. I think I would have trouble doing that.
Yeah, me too. But let's listen and see if Anna has trouble sneaking down the air duct.
I have never snuck down an air duct. It's dark and small. I'm afraid of dark, small places.
You can do it, Agent Flamingo. You know, spies aren't afraid of a little darkness.
Right. It's just an air duct. Dark, small air duct. Okay, I'm doing it, Agent Peacock. I am sneaking down a long, dark, small air duct. I'm having a little trouble breathing.
Just keep going, Agent Flamingo. Think of the team.
Okay, I will think of the team. I'm thinking of the team, Agent Peacock. I did it! I did it! I sneaked down an air duct. That was a little uncomfortable.
Good.
Anna was able to sneak down the air duct, but she had a little trouble breathing because she was nervous.
When we say we have trouble doing something, we mean that it is difficult for us to do.
And here are rules for using that expression. We use the preposition with when a noun follows have trouble. For example, students can say they are having trouble with their homework.
And if we use a verb after have trouble, we must use the gerund or ing form of the verb. So we can say the students are having trouble doing their homework.
I also noticed that Ms. Weaver and Anna both used the expression afraid of. Because the word of is a preposition, if we use a verb after it, that verb must also use the gerund or ing form of the verb.
For example, if you are having some big problems with a friend, you might say you are afraid of losing your friendship.
And the expression scared of means the same thing as afraid of. Anna said she is afraid of dark, small places. Listeners, what kinds of places or situations are you afraid of? Write to us at learningenglish@voanews.com and let us know.
Andrew, before we go, we should find out what other reasons Miss Weaver had for sending Anna to the museum.
One reason that you can learn when you watch the video is simply to make Anna try to do some difficult things, like hanging from a bar, breaking a code, or crawling through a small space. But the other reason is connected to Ms. Weaver's stomach.
Her stomach?
Yes. Let's listen.
The International Spy Museum is awesome! Agent Peacock, I completed the mission.
Great.
Now, I have another very important mission for you.
Got it. See you back at HQ.
Yummy! You brought my lunch. Thanks, Agent Flamingo.
Mission completed, Agent Peacock.
Ms. Weaver gave Anna the mission of bringing her lunch. Maybe that's because the spy museum is near some good restaurants.
Maybe so.
And HQ is short for headquarters. In this case, HQ is the office where Ms. Weaver works.
Yes, and bringing lunch is not exactly a spy mission, but as we know, Anna has a big imagination.
Well, now I'm getting hungry for my own lunch, so it's time to say goodbye for now. We hope you've enjoyed this lesson of the day on the Learning English podcast. I'm Jill Robbins.
And don't forget to write to us. And remember that you can find us on YouTube, Facebook, and Instagram. I'm Andrew Smith.
That's our program for today. Join us again tomorrow to keep learning English through stories from around the world. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter Jr.